Now stop beating your gums and sound the attack.
All right. Hello, 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 and welcome everyone to another episode of the We Got the Chocolates podcast. And welcome back, Mitch and Sam. Thank you very much for being here. Now, obviously, this is our first episode back. It is the 36th episode, as we mentioned, but more importantly, it is our first episode of season three, which is very exciting after obviously a 4-week layoff. So thanks very much for being here, guys. It's great to see that your contracts were renewed. Obviously, some tough times probably financially for a lot of people at the moment, but you two are still here.
Yeah, managed to not get let down, stood down during the off season, so that was good news. It's good to be back, Leigh, although I have seen plenty of you given we live together, but yes. Always a pleasure.
Yeah, hey lads, hey listeners out there, certainly were long and painful negotiations to get me back for season three, but I'm looking forward to another season.
No, not a cheap man to get on board, unfortunately. There's one thing that will remain consistent over season three, that's for sure.
Yeah, I feel like I bring plenty to the table, but it's good to be back for another season, and it's felt like a long time with you planning and teaching and marking at school, Leigh, so I haven't had much sport either lately with everything going on.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. It started a little bit earlier for you, hasn't it? The off season. And we're doing, we got through our full season, but then obviously finals cricket all called off for Queensland cricket. And then for you guys, given that it's meant to be a job, it's really up in the air.
Yeah, that's correct. So it didn't affect us too much, thankfully, as cricketers. But yeah, our final Shield game of the season was cancelled. And then with that, our chances of making it into the Shield final. So that was disappointing. But
then they didn't end up playing the Shield final either, in fairness. So
correct.
Just announced New South Wales as winners. There's a one piece of sporting news we can cover.
That's it.
Yeah, that's great. I guess this time, guys, for this episode, we were fortunate enough. We obviously recorded this a couple of weeks ago, probably a few weeks back, but we're definitely fortunate enough to get this person on board. Has actually represented her country, I think I'm right in saying has.
Yeah.
Played internationally in netball, which is, again, a first for the podcast. Someone we haven't got to interview from that sport before. So Jemma Mi Mi is the interview that you're about to listen to. That's the one coming up. Excellent. thanks, Skinnard. Obviously, did a few speaking lessons over the off season. Season break.
Working hard on me word count should be a lot better this season. Hopefully, as an example, right there.
We will let you off though, Skinnard. It was your birthday yesterday, so happy birthday from everyone out there. We got chocolates, listeners.
Oh yeah, thanks, Leigh. It was a very exciting birthday. Locked up inside, we probably should mention that. As you said, we recorded this a few weeks ago now, sort of before the old COVID-19 became a massive issue. Then we were sort of under the impression that everything was going to carry on as per normal for the remainder of the year, but things have obviously changed a bit since then. So yeah, I was in lockdown yesterday and not the greatest birthday ever, but probably more importantly, wanted to send some thoughts and anything nice. I would normally say prayers, but I'm not a particularly religious man. Anyone that's sort of been affected by the coronavirus, and just hope that all our listeners are safe and healthy at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Absolutely. Yeah, just definitely second those sentiments. That's for sure. But we do hope, obviously, that this episode, we obviously probably you need more time now. You need some things to listen to more than ever. So hopefully, Jemma is a fantastic person to speak to, and she was very, very entertaining, I must say, as well. So hopefully, this gives you a little bit of relief from obviously a really ordinary situation that is going on at the moment. But we really hope that you enjoy this interview. And this is how it went. All right. Hello and welcome, everyone. And today we are actually branching out and have been lucky to get hold of a professional netball player, in fact, which is not something we've had the pleasure of being able to say before, who we are getting to speak to today on the podcast. She's actually played 25 games for the Queensland Firebirds in the Suncorp Super Netball League since her debut in 2017. And as of last year, was the only Indigenous athlete in the competition. So the person that we have the pleasure of speaking to today is Jemma Mi Mi. Jemma, thank you very much for being here. How
thanks
are you?
For having us. Yeah, I'm good, thanks.
It's great. That's nice microphone etiquette that you've got, and a couple of your favourite cricket autobiographies have been utilised there again as the microphone stand.
No worries. Yeah, thanks for lending them to me.
That's all right. Might take you a while to get through them, actually. Obviously, Sam and Mitch are both here as well. No need to introduce you usually, guys, because you're a staple part.
But hey guys.
Maybe just introduce yourselves to Jemma.
Hey, how's it going?
What's amazing too here is that normally Jemma people can't tell myself and Mitch's voice apart, but given that you're actually in the studio, then you're actually able to see who's talking. So that's really going to be quite handy for everyone concerned.
Won't have that problem.
Exactly right. Now, Jemma, netball, I must admit, was the one sort of sport, probably not one sport, but certainly, well, actually, yeah, I would back that in and say the one sport that I was horrific at school. Okay. Probably my worst PE mark ever came from netball. So, and even now when I, like, we have to teach it at school and I find myself having to umpire it, I get so freaked out about getting abused by all players. So I'm going to let Haz take the next question to get us started because it's an area that he's quite strong in.
Netball, well, yeah, that would suggest that I'm good at it, but I'm definitely not good at netball either. I think as soon as I get the ball, I want to keep running with it and not stop.
Yeah, that's what did me. I always got done for stepping left, right and centre.
But yeah, something we like to start with when we talk to athletes is talking about nicknames. So I've been told you had a nickname that used to make a lot of sense when you were younger, but now probably doesn't make too much sense. What is that nickname?
Yeah, so this nickname came from the times when I was playing touch footy. Yeah, back then I was one of the tallest and lankiest players out on the field and my nickname was Lank back then, but yeah, it definitely doesn't apply now when I'm on the netball court.
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot of tall netballers, aren't there?
Yeah, so definitely.
So in comparison, because like I look at you when you walk through the door and go, well, she's quite tall, but that's from my vantage point, yeah, which is
4'9".
Okay, yeah. Thanks, Skin. Yeah. So in the actual netball competition, I assume that you're really not that vertically Skin. How about it?
I have no idea where you're going.
I assume you're not that tall in comparison to other players.
Yeah, definitely being a mid-court player. I definitely couldn't be a shooter or a circle defender as I just don't have the height to get around big, tall hands. But yeah, as a midi, I can just use, I guess, my other strengths. So yeah, being fast and zippy around the court.
Very good.
Yeah.
New nickname, Zippy.
Yeah, there
okay.
we are.
I'll take
it's
it.
Yeah, it's actually a good one.
Are there any other nicknames you get called in the netball court or anywhere else?
Not much on the netball court, but I remember, back to the touch footy days when I would play with all my sisters and there'd be sometimes three of us on the same teams and we all just got my my. Didn't matter who it was. It was just all my mind. Just made it easier for everyone on the team.
Easier for everyone else. Maybe not you three.
Yeah, no, that's all right. We all responded that.
Well, Gemma, I do have to make a slight confession. And if it goes poorly, then we'll edit it out. But okay. You used to work at Fish on Fire. It's probably not something that everyone needs to know. But you did
check them out.
Yeah, you used to work at Fish on Fire. Great supporter of the show. Not at all. But one time when you were serving us, me, Mitch, Mum and my sister were there eating and you came and served us, gave us the meal and I was like, my, my, what a wonderful meal. Everyone thought it was hilarious.
Oh my gosh, I didn't. Nah. I would have just thought, what a weirdo, and walked away.
Yeah, but I think that's exactly what happened.
You're the only one who thinks you're funny.
Oh, well, Skin, you got to entertain yourself, I guess.
This is true.
Do you have a question for us, Mitch?
I do. Jemmy, you've already touched on touch footy a couple of times, but I understand you've been quite athletic growing up. I was wondering if you could run us through what other sports you've played and at what levels and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I played, just kind of any sport under the sun. I remember just growing up, played a bit of cricket.
What? Serious?
Just for fun.
Another sport you're probably better at.
Yeah. did a lot of athletics, liked all the jumping events, high jump, long jump, the short sprints, bit of cross country as well. Yeah, just liked being active, I guess.
You really struggled in sporting endeavours. Oh, dear me. And Gemma, that's actually a trait for, well, you've got three sisters as well, don't you? I hope I've got that right.
Yeah, three younger sisters.
Perfect. And that's a trait that's quite similar across the board for all of the Mi-Mi's, isn't it?
Yeah.
How about that? Give us a bit of background on what your sisters are doing because they're quite sporty in their own right too.
Yeah, they are. So I've got three younger sisters, Rebecca and Kayla. They're twins and they're about they're 18 months younger than me, and they play at the moment they're focusing on their touch footy. But they used to do athletics and cross country throughout school, and I made them play netball with me in the school netball team because I was the only grade 12 girl in that team, and I was like, well, Becca and Kayla are fit. They can just come and run around. So
when you're in grade 12, what grade were they in?
11.
Okay, grade 11. So just the 1 year
difference. Yeah, so okay. Got them into that team. And Lisa, I never played much touch footy with her just because of the age difference. Mm. But she's still playing her touch footy and netball as well and doing really well in that.
Yeah. And yeah. I taught Lisa as well, so there's probably, some correspondence there, some correlation between very naturally gifted athlete / also coached by Lethal equals superstar.
Small city out here in the Redlands. Everyone knows each other out here in the Redlands, don't they? There's some link somehow. Because I went to the school in the same area, I used to grow up and go to athletics and cross country carnivals, and the my name was always doing very well, and your sisters and yourself were always on the microphone having won events and getting medals in events. So I do remember that. But being the oldest, did you have much of a sibling rivalry growing up? Did you play netball or touch footy in the backyard or at the park and you have that sibling rivalry?
Yeah. I probably wouldn't say it was more of a rivalry. We were pretty nice to each other because we knew we were always going to be on the same team. So we always were out in the backyard learning all the moves and stuff. that's just what you do. Yeah. And I remember the three of us would always teach Lisa as well. So,
What's the age difference between then Lisa, you and Lisa?
5 years.
Okay, so that was a bit more of a substantial gap.
Yeah, yes.
So I always remember her being like the little baby that was just running around.
I know, she was just always there.
Exactly. Okay, that makes sense.
I know Leigh and Mitch always have this argument of who's the most talented athlete in the family all the time. I'm no doubt I am the most talented athlete in my family out of any siblings anyway.
I mean, it's a pretty easy argument in our family as well.
You reckon? Yeah, I'll take it.
No.
Yeah. I thought you must have been talking about Mitch as well.
But that's really backfired then. Who is it in your family then? Who's a nice naturally gifted athlete? You've got to be able to choose.
Gosh. I'd like to say myself.
it's definitely. Okay.
Yeah. Very fair. We'll go with that.
Yeah, well, no one else has become a professional leader.
Touch footy is not a professional sport, unfortunately.
Yeah, this is true. It was touch footy at the moment. The better you are, the more it costs you.
Pretty much.
That's frustrating. What do you put that athletic ability throughout your whole family down to? Like, that seems like it's sort of just too good to be a coincidence that everyone's a gun at everything.
Yeah. I guess we've got good genes from mum and dad. Yeah, right. They were both really sporty growing up.
Okay.
And I guess they always wanted to make sure that we were active as well growing up. So they got us into all our sport. So, yeah. And they were always there coaching. Dad coached our touch footy team. Mum never coached me on netball. The one time she did, I made her cry and then I cried as well. So she didn't coach me after that.
But you and Jemma are pretty close in age. Did you play touch footy against each other? You probably wouldn't have played netball against each other.
Yeah.
Oh, netball? Yeah.
Real strong.
Real strength on netball. But no, I think I've played a bit of touch against you.
Yeah.
Growing up, sort of around the same age, I suppose. So.
Yeah.
Because Mitch was actually quite good when he was young as well, and then he just stunk it up as he got older.
Sort of slowly faded as he carried on getting better.
Is at the wrong end of the bell curve. For sure. Jemma, you were born in Newcastle.
Yes.
Correct?
Yeah, correct.
Excellent. Grabbing 2 from 2 in the statements here.
Just good Googling. Yeah.
Thank you very much. At what age did you actually move up to Queensland, make the move to the Sunshine State?
Yeah. So my sisters were also born in Newcastle as well. So
all of them?
No, just the three eldest. Yeah. And then we moved to Townsville. And I reckon, it would have been pretty young. I would say like maybe 2 or 3. Yeah, moved to Townsville. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, right. And so what does that mean for your state of origin sort of endeavours? Who do you follow and play for in touch and stuff if you have played for them?
Definitely Queensland.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Your sister certainly played for Queensland.
Yeah, we've all played for Queensland.
We all have now.
Kayla's the only one who backs the cockroaches.
No, it does not surprise me somehow.
Yeah.
It'll be good for her the last couple of years, being the one in the family happy when they have one. Your partner, Grant, and I are good mates and grew up playing a lot of rugby league together. So I know he loves his footy. Do you follow it at all? Do you watch it with him at home when he's watching it on TV? Or?
Yeah, definitely. Well, he's got the KO app, so we're always watching, you know, any footy games up there. But yeah, I used to watch it before, but it's always on the telly, all the rugby.
Oh, lovely.
Mm. Yeah.
Do you get him out in the backyard or on the court and play netball against him at all?
Sometimes. Nah, he's always the one wanting to go out and pass the footy.
Really?
Yeah. Well, we've just got in, he's just started playing AFL.
Right. Oh, yeah. Hell. Who's he playing for? Not Alex Hills, two reserves. Is
yeah,
it?
Yeah. Literally. Are you
Leigh and I have played there a little bit over the past. We haven't been training or anything because we've been at, cricket's still been going.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm on the Facebook group and saw his name pop up the other day. I was like, hey.
Oh, yeah.
Jeez, you've just finger on the pulse, Mitch. You don't miss a beat.
Yeah, no. All over it.
Knows what everyone's having.
How's
going
he
going
to go? Is he, will he be strong? Any ideas of. Is he going to single-handedly win us a flag? We probably need that.
Yeah, that would be very handy.
Well, he's never played before it, so he's still learning the rules, but he's playing
that's
like,
not a great.
Yeah, nah. It's just more, he's just playing for fitness and he's playing on the back.
Yeah, yeah. So perfect. That's fair. He'll be with Mitch. He'll be right across the back line there.
Mm. Yeah, if he hasn't taken my spot, so
probably see his rugby kicking technique instead of an
they all got up
Oh, so he'll kick like a rugby player though. He'll fit right in then.
Okay.
Yeah. Perfect.
I can barely kick at all, so.
And now, Jemma, your season, netball season obviously is only actually a couple of months away, I would say. So what does your pre-season training block look like now? I know you were just talking to us before we started recording about the lack of air conditioning and how nice it is when you do have some air conditioning, but what does a pre-season training look like for you at the moment?
So we're pretty much in the depth of our pre-season, so it's pretty tough, but we're training every day during the week. Well, we get the weekends off, which is good, so Mondays are like we start at 7 and we usually get out about 10:30. That's a court session, conditioning session and a weight session. So that's our big day, and then we're back Monday arvo for meetings. Tuesdays similar in the morning, 7 till about 10. Mm-hmm. Conditioning and court work. Wednesday mornings just a gym session. Thursdays gym in the morning, court in the afternoon, and then Friday arvos. We usually do match play against the Fusion team, which is the Queensland team below the Firebirds, or we play against the Queensland men's team, which is pretty fun.
How do the Queensland men's team go?
They're strong. Good. Yeah, there's some big boys in that team who are just solid and obviously the bigger the body, it's hard to get around. If you're defending them, they're tall boys there as well. There's this one guy, his name's Lockie, and he just gets the ball in one hand and he can literally just place it in in the hoop. Yeah,
just doing slam dunks.
Pretty much, it's insane. And he defends as well, so he's
And excuse my lack of knowledge here, but do the men's have like a weekly competition as well? Are they playing like a proper?
Yeah, there's definitely weekly comps. I don't think there's any going on at the moment, but they have like a nationals as well. Yeah, where they play all the states. Nice. And Queensland, I believe they won last year, but they've lost a couple of their players. So hopefully they can, back it up.
Hopefully those players are also coming to Alex Hills Bombers. We have a really handy team.
With that height.
Yeah, exactly. We get that Lockie fella down.
Yeah.
Real handy.
He'd be good.
And you recently went to New Zealand for a pre-season camp or whatever you would call it, and we often use a photo on Instagram to advertise the episodes we put on for the podcast, and I think we got a pretty good photo from that camp.
It's actually in front of Jemma over there. I placed it in front of it.
So I think we might use that one, that you took a bit of a dramatic fall after contact with an opposition player there.
Yeah, I can be a bit over dramatic whenever trying to maybe get a contact call, but I did get the contact call on that photo.
Oh, well, that's so, mission accomplished.
Yeah, there we go. I got
put
the
a
ball.
Little speech bubble in there that says that, just to clarify. A little bit of photo editing. That's fantastic.
And Jemma, I understand last year you got a lot more game time than you ever have before. Sorry, I can't speak. But which was great news, especially after you missed a big part of the previous season with an ankle injury. And I understand you've had to have a pretty big surgery on that. How did that all go for you?
Yeah, so my first two seasons I was out a lot of it because of, just a lot of rolled ankles. Right. So the end of my second season I decided to get an ankle reconstruction on my left ankle.
Jemma, when you say decided to get, like, is that genuinely like people come up to you as like a multiple choice question and go, look, would you like to do this, this or this? And you actually have to choose, like, I'll get the reconstruction. Like, what were your other options?
Yeah, well, just to not get the surgery.
I'll keep playing with a bung ankle, thanks.
Yeah,
physio treatment.
Yeah.
Come see Sam Hazlitt.
I think the option came up through my physio, our team physio, and then spoke to our team doctor, and then I met the surgeon, and then talking to my coach. So it was a big decision because I knew I was going to be off legs for quite a substantial amount of time, and I wanted to make sure that I didn't miss too much or lose too much fitness. So, looking back, it was definitely the right decision to make.
Yeah, definitely. A teammate of yours has actually told us that you use strapping all the time, and a big user of strapping. So what's the most amount of body parts you think you've strapped at any one time?
Oh, yeah. both ankles, knee. Had like that kinesio tape.
Yeah.
Have that sometimes as well. But then I also have to wear my ankle braces as well, so.
It's really not a great sport on the joints, netball.
Nah, is it?
A lot of change
not.
Of direction and hard surface.
Yeah. High-impact sport for sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The other thing I was just thinking, by the way, Haz, you asked this question a bit, so I'm just rewinding. You asked this question a while ago. When you talk about, like, getting a partner out on the court, like, to practice netball, netball's, like, one sport that would be really, really hard to have, like, a 1v1 battle, you know? Football is a one-on-one. Like, we'll play the five-meter game. Yeah. Basketball is, like, everyone's, like, one-on-one, try and skin each other. It's like netball is, like, outstepping.
Yeah, pretty much. If it was like a one-on-one, you'd just be shooting, but I don't shoot.
Yeah.
So.
That's right. Sorry, Haz. I was just thinking about that then. The other thing that I was thinking about as well, Jemma, off the cuff here, is if you were, like, you've gone from playing a lot of touch, obviously, to now being a professional netballer, would it be incredibly frowned upon for you to just randomly find yourself on a touch football field?
Like, I'm still playing netball.
Yeah. Is that outlawed completely?
Oh, yes, definitely. Okay. It's in our contract. Yeah. We're not allowed to play any other sport.
Okay. I wasn't hinting towards anything. Filling social teams.
I think my surfing's frowned upon for cricket as well, but I still go out and surf.
Yeah, so, I feel like surfing's slightly less risk. Well, although if you get eaten by a shark, it's not great for your cricket.
No, that hurts. But you're right. I think the ACLs and stuff get done a lot.
Yeah, the cruciates are in better condition than surfing usually.
Netball, yeah.
You had a follow-up question, didn't you?
The same teammate we talked to also said that you're extremely nice and kind to everyone. So she wants to know if there's ever been a time you've lost your cool and blown up at someone on the netball court or anywhere.
Nah. Yeah, I probably won't say anything, but it's usually like I'll just give him like a good old nudge, little shoulder charge.
Yeah,
to a player, but
you're coming to the Bombers as well. Outstanding.
Yeah, it always annoys me when I played AFL or anything, when someone would nudge me off the ball. Yeah, like, there's nothing going on here.
You can get away with some stuff in netball.
Can you stop using this podcast as a platform to just air all your grievances about AFL? Very true. The three of us are actually, one of us is a very good cricketer, and then two of us try quite hard. But we all play cricket, I guess. We'll donate a percentage of our weekend to playing cricket. And within that sport, sledging, I guess, and mind games are sort of a tactic that are utilised quite often, probably more often against us than what we actually go on the front foot doing. But I was wondering, is that ever a part of netball? Is that ever something that you find yourself like little sledging battles, little like, you're no chance of getting this as they're shooting? Like, is that type of thing frowned upon? Is that in the etiquette of the game, or is that okay?
Well, yeah. People do it. It's not, I guess, round. Well, maybe it is. I don't know. It depends who the person is. But yeah, it's usually for us middies, maybe along on the circle's edge if the opponent's goal attack or goal shoot is putting up a shot. And we're just yelling, get the rebound, just stuff like that, just to get in their head a little bit.
That's clever.
It's like
indirect sledging.
Yeah.
if you're playing in front of a crowd, I guess the crowd's going to be yelling out taunts and stuff every now and then too. So,
yeah, definitely.
And they're a bit closer on the netball court than a cricket field. In the cricket field, the crowds, you can't hear what they're saying, you just hear noise. But if the netball court's, the crowd's a bit closer. Mm.
But I've got the worst hearing. I can't hear anything. It's just all noise.
Yeah.
Even if the coach is yelling, I'm like, what do you want?
You're just so focused on the task at hand. That's pretty what much. It is, Jemma. Just block everything else out. No distractions.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. How's you on the next question?
I don't think so. I think you are, but we could say that you played a couple of different positions on the netball court, but obviously you've played a lot of centre now. Yeah. So is that your favourite position? Do you want to stay there?
I don't mind. I'll just go wherever I need to go, centre or wing attack. But, yeah, definitely played a lot more centre towards the back end of last season with Hull's going down. But hopefully she's going to be back by round one this season, so it'll be good to get back playing with her.
Yep.
Yeah.
Good.
Great news. And I also don't have great knowledge of netball, but I imagine you're doing a fair bit of running in the centre position. Yep. Have you? I was wondering if you've ever been able to wear one of those little GPS tracking devices, and what sort of distance are you covering again?
Yeah, we always wear our GPS in our trainings and games. But it's a bit tricky to track how many Ks we run because of there's a lot of interference going around. But I think we can get up to maybe like 5-6 Ks a game.
Okay.
Yeah.
A lot of high intensity sprints.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Yeah, definitely. It's a lot more just.
That's a tough gig.
Yeah, definitely. And in terms of this upcoming season, Jemma, are you probably expecting this to be, again, a season where you... That was a loud bird. are you expecting this to be a season where you, again, probably that game time increases, I guess, on the back of a retirement, obviously, from who was that from? That was from last year's vice-captain, actually.
Yeah, Katie.
Katie, that's right.
Well, I was lucky enough to get on court every game last season and hopefully can do that again this season. Yeah. But we've had a couple of changes, obviously, to our lineup with – some girls retiring, so which is good because it makes our group really competitive within ourselves as well to want to get court time. Mm, yeah,
definitely. And with more games and more travelling away from home, you're away from your partner, but more importantly, you're away from your dogs. So can you tell us a bit about your dogs?
Yeah,
I believe there's a bit of a sort of unusual friendship there with the two dogs and you and your partner about whose favourite dog is which.
Oh, yeah. So our first dog we got, he's a cavoodle and we've called him Bruce. He's a little cutie. Yeah.
It just makes sense.
Big Bruce.
Yeah, he's great. So that was, I guess, meant to be... my dog. So we got that when Grant was still in the army. So he was moving around away a lot of the time. So Bruce was there as a companion dog for me. But Bruce is pretty much now Grant's dog because he's always there just trying to impress Grant. Bruce will do anything like sit and I'll just be like, oh my gosh, you're amazing. Come here. And then our second dog, her name's Ida and she's a American Bulldog cross ridgeback and she's just the biggest buff head. She's so funny. That was meant to be Grant's dog, but now she's my dog.
There you go.
That's it.
And Jemma, I understand that the Queensland Firebirds were very dominant a few years ago. They were runners-up in 2013 and 14 and won the national competition in 2011, 15 and 16, but haven't sort of reached the same heights in the last few years. I was wondering if you could give us any idea about what they need to do in 2020 to get back to that stage.
Yeah, Firebirds have definitely had a couple of successful seasons a while ago. But, and last year definitely wasn't our best and we're definitely, this year here to make a comeback for sure. And we've got a couple new girls in our team who have, lifted us a bit and especially in like the culture side of things.
Okay.
But I think we've also got our old S&C coach back, Brinley. So he was with the girls in when they won the 2015 and 2016 championships, and he's been really great because he...
Where did he go after that?
He moved to the Lions for a bit and then to the Reds.
Oh, right.
Okay. Yeah, so...
Decent resume then.
Yeah, no, he's really great, and he's really pushing us at our trainings to train a lot harder than how we play on game day. So making... Yeah, when we go out and play, it's a lot easier.
Yeah, I like that.
That's the way to be. So we've been doing that all throughout preseason, and yeah, we've got some preseason games in March against all the other teams in Sydney. So they'll be good to test it there.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Like is there much sort of changing from sort of, I guess, franchise to franchise within netball? Like, is there much sort of players coming from like a different state or whatever, moving into state to try and, I guess, reignite their careers or just for a different challenge or anything like that?
Yeah, so we've had a couple girls come from Melbourne. So they were in the Melbourne teams and now come up to the Firebirds. And I guess it's been interesting talking to them. With the Melbourne teams, they're a little bit more structured and they play their plays and that's it. Whereas we like to play a little bit more.
Bit of ab lib.
Yeah, definitely. Ab lib.
Harlem Globetrotters.
Well, yeah, well, we've got Gretz who's got that basketball background.
Yeah, so true.
Yeah, she's bringing the layup into our game, and we've seen a lot more shooters doing it in the comp, which is really cool. And that's what I like. I like to play a bit ab lib and have like a little bit of structure when needed, but you just play what's in front of you. Yeah.
I've been told you're a little bit structured in terms of your game day routine and you like to have a bit of a game day routine, but I've also been told that game day routine changes quite regularly.
Tell us a bit about that. So I think I remember I went out to Brekkie or something before a game and I played really good and we won that game, and I said to Grant, I was like, Grant, now we have to go out to Brekkie every time.
To that same place or just... Out to Brekkie in general.
Just go out for Brekkie, didn't matter where.
Okay. See, I feel like I would be like real particular about going to the same place every time.
Yeah, everyone's funny that way. Like everyone's got their, you know, little rituals and whatever they do. But yeah, I just make sure. I always like to have pasta before game day. Mm-hmm. That's been embedded into me since, living at home with mum and dad.
Your carb loading.
Yeah, that's it.
By the way, Gemma, did you hear about that Italian chef?
No.
Yeah, I'm sorry to tell you that he passed away.
Yeah, that was
good one.
Fantastic. I understand why I started shaking my head before. The so I've heard that.
I was like, is this legit? Like,
yeah, did you not see that in the script? So weird. Has highlighted that a different colour. It was white with no writing.
I'm a pest.
Sorry, everyone.
It's all right.
Anyways, Gemma, I understand last year you were picked in the Australia A development team to play in Auckland against New Zealand A and England A, which I imagine would have been a fairly good experience for you. How did you go over there and individually, and how did the team go in the competition?
It's probably been one of the highlights of my netball career so far, kind of making that next step, I guess, into an Aussie development squad. That competition was really cool. It was quite it was a closed event, so not a lot of it got advertised. But we went really well. We won every game over in Auckland. But then before that, we were at the AIS to do a couple of training sessions with the squad, and England was over there at the time. And so we got a couple of games in there before, and we lost our first game. But then we won every other game after that. So it was really cool just playing with the other girls from the different states. Learning new things and having different coaches as well. It was awesome.
That's so cool. Moving away from netball for a second, Gemma, what are you actually studying at university?
Mm-hmm. So I'm at QUT and I'm studying a Bachelor of Clinical Exercise Physiology.
And you're quite deep into that degree, aren't you? Like, you've been doing it for a while.
Yeah, this is my last year. Yeah, so I've been doing it full time and part time. I'm on my sixth year of study.
Yeah, and is that bad? Is it difficult to manage? Like, does university have to be flexible, and also the Firebirds have to be flexible
Making
sure that you're able to do both there?
Both sides kind of have to give a bit. But this year's been pretty good. Uni's making sure that I can graduate at the end of this year. And same with Rose, my coach. I was able to get all of last week off to make sure I get into uni every day, which has been, yeah, really good. So there is flexibility, but at the end of the day, kind of netball is the number one. So uni, they've got like the elite athlete program there at uni. So I'm in there and I've got lots of support from them.
You're in that house? Elite athlete program? We've got
some help at Griffith. They've got a really good sports college, they call it there. And yeah, they work well with cricket to make sure I can fit everything in.
Mm, perfect. Mm. Outstanding. And the, I guess life after netball, where would that degree sort of take you into? What would be the ideal job for you with that degree, do you think?
Yeah, I'd like to work with, I've got an interest in working with elderly patients. I think they're just really great. They just love a chat.
So fair.
Share a few life experiences.
Yeah, definitely. So I think I wouldn't mind working in like a private practice or a hospital, just kind of wherever I could get a job, really. Yeah, that's the plan, I guess.
Brilliant.
And also one other question I have. We've talked lots about your sporting endeavours and prowess in that field. Any other talents that you have? I know, like, I've seen you sort of out of the corner of your eye eyeing off that guitar over there.
Is there any
that's obviously available for you to just produce your favourite karaoke song? Probably an entirely different question, actually. We'll ask that one next. But any other talents? Any other talents that you have?
Any other talents?
Mm.
Oh, I've got a bit of a weird one.
Oh, go on.
It's probably going to embarrass me heaps, but...
Oh, well, this won't go to anyone.
Yeah. I can do a really good impersonation of a sheep.
What? Please demonstrate.
Come on. You can't just give us that.
That's amazing.
That just went a completely different way to what I was expecting.
I was like, I can do a really good impersonation of Donald Trump or
like some celebrity and a sheep.
Oh, please.
I've really thrown myself under the bus here.
Give yourself a moment to compose yourself and then let's get this sheep onto it. Well, I mean, that's probably enough from Jemma, and then we'll just interview the sheep for the rest of the time, I think.
You probably get a bit more out of it. All right, okay.
Okay, let's go.
Ready?
Oh, my goodness me. That is actually so much better than I thought.
How does that come about? How do you just think?
How did you work out that you were good at that?
Yeah.
I don't know. When I was little, who knows? We were playing like farm animals and sheep came about.
Oh, that is elite. Okay, and because I...
How do you follow that?
So I assume your favourite karaoke song is Baba. Favourite nursery rhyme. What would actually be your karaoke tune of choice, Jemma? What are you going to get? You need to get the crowd up and about. It's a really bland night.
Yeah.
You come in, stage left.
Yeah.
What are you producing?
Well, I'm not the greatest singer, but I love some Whitney Houston or... Yeah, Whitney Houston, I want to dance with somebody.
Pretty hard voice to copy.
I give it a good crack. Maybe towards the later end of the night. Yeah.
Mitch, you'd be able to do that, wouldn't you?
No, I don't think I've got Whitney Houston in my arsenal. But
that's a shame.
And I shy away from karaoke as much as I can. I actually went to a karaoke night the other night and just sat in the corner quietly bobbing my head, so that was kind of fun.
Surely you could have got some Eminem up there.
I probably could have had a crack at Eminem, but no, wasn't feeling it. Has a bit shy stage.
Missed opportunity.
Yeah.
Gun shy skin.
Yeah, oh well. But Eloise got up and did, what is that song? Yeah, some song from Glee or something. Like, her and her friend were up there putting on a massive performance of that. Yeah, that was good viewing.
That is good viewing. Do I have the next question? I feel like I'm done there because I've hogged a lot.
Yes,
there.
Yeah, and we've
and I'm just going to quickly. I'm just going to quickly look up. I want to dance with somebody so we can play that.
Okay, perfect. Well, I'll carry on then, I suppose. We have seriously digressed from wherever we were meant to be going, but I think I was getting back to your time management. According to your LinkedIn profile, at least, you also managed to squeeze in a little bit of part-time work as a customer service representative. I was wondering if you're sort of still doing that often now with netball and stuff, and how that's going.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So like we spoke about before, I used to work at fish and chip shop.
Yep. Good fish and chip shop.
Yeah. And I was contracted while I was still working at the fish and chip shop, and my mum was chatting to a family friend who worked at Lysart is the company, and they were saying, oh, congrats on Jemma, you know, making Firebirds. What's she doing for work? And like just talking about like if I could live off netball pay or whatever. And they were saying, oh, yeah, no, she's really excited. She's still at, you know, the fish and chip shop. And he's like, what? Can't have a professional athlete working at a fish and chip shop. And then he was lucky enough to just give me a job doing some admin work and customer service with his company. So that was really cool, and I've just been working there ever since. Yeah, they're really flexible with me. I just let them know week to week what my schedule's like, and they can just fit me in. So
Good news. And do you have had any clients recognize you as a netballer?
Yeah, a little bit. Well, it's funny with Lysard, I'm a bit of an ambassador for them as well, so they use my image and some of their marketing events and whatever, and they've put me on the side of a big truck. So it's got Gordon Tallis and my head on a big truck, and
just head as well.
Yeah, just like shoulders up. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Nice.
Yeah. So that's pretty funny, and that goes all the way from Brizzy to sometimes goes to the Northern Territory doing deliveries and.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. So I do get when I go to like netball events where. Teams that like come from Mackay, for example, they say, oh, we've seen your face on the truck, and I'm like, oh, okay, cool.
That would be very odd. Yeah, that is just thought, like, but imagine if you're just driving and then you look to your right and just see like your own face.
Yes, well, that's what people have said. Truck. They've just said,
wow, that's quite intriguing. Very fair.
I think Gordon Tallis, that's a big name. That's
correct. Well, it's probably Jemma above. Jemma more relevant these days. Gordon Tallis is on NRL 360 now.
probably a good chance now for me to ask probably the most important question of the interview. And that's, how's your Pokemon training going? Any big catches there lately?
What? Why did you not bring this up in the talent section?
Yeah, this is another stitch up. Grant got me onto Pokemon.
Right.
I'll say that. I'll put that out there right now. So he got the Pokemon Go app and started playing Pokemon, and he wanted me to be his friend on it. So
there's actually a man very close to you on your right hand side that is always. I loved how you had to look really, really.
Yeah. These ones.
She thought she was being attacked by a random person. Just, I don't want to alarm you, but there is someone walking towards you. Right. No, Mitch, also massive fan of Pokemon Go. Like, we used to go for dinner and stuff. I'm like, what are you doing? And he's literally trying to catch like some random Pokemon just walking into the middle of the street.
Yeah, that's true. And I've managed to wean myself off it. I was wasting a bit too much time on the app. So
it can get addictive.
Yeah, I've sort of gotten off it a little bit now, but yeah, I've obviously played a lot of Pokemon growing up and was a bit excited when the app finally came out. But.
They're still one of those people that goes in the bunch when there's a area where everyone has to go to catch the rare Pokemon or whatever.
Nah,
it is.
I never did that. Grant did it though.
They were weird. They're like flash mobs trying to catch a Bulbasaur. Very fair.
I'm back up. All right. Yeah, I think so. I was just going to ask if the outside of Pokemon Go and netball, what other hobbies you get up to in your spare time?
Yeah.
I can almost give you the answer, Iskin.
Okay. Oh.
You can't hear because it's annoying. Pass your headphones over. Oh, yep. That's a proper tune though, in fairness.
Yeah, it is great. It gets the crowd going.
You didn't look as upbeat about that song, to be honest. I was expecting you to launch into the first verse there.
No, well, I actually did get asked the other day who I thought the best singer of all time was. And
you said Jemma Mi Mi. Unbelievable. So resourceful from you to just promote her like that before we've even done the interview.
I had to think on the spot quickly, and I did say Whitney Houston, so
that's not a bad answer, though, surely.
Yeah, I don't know much about singing.
Freddie Mercury out there.
Mentioned him a couple of times on podcast recently.
The person I was talking to disagreed strongly and thought it was Elvis Presley. So
Elvis Presley, overrated.
Wow. That's a massive call.
I have no idea.
The greatest artist of all time. Yeah.
How do you define greatest artist of all time?
Oh, maybe in records sold and things like that, I would think.
Oh, so wait, is he actually the greatest artist ever of all time?
He'd be up there, surely. It'd have to be.
Surely. Yeah.
You find it out. Wait, who's asking this question?
Just giving him a hosing. I'll find out.
Okay.
I don't know.
You are also mid-question here.
Is he the king of rock or
something? Yeah, king of
something.
What is his king of? Well, he's just the king, isn't he?
Yeah, I thought so. I don't know. We probably should be talking to Mum about this because she was his number one fan growing up, apparently. So, maybe.
And he ate peanut butter just out of a jar.
Yeah, I think he had a rogue diet.
Yeah, like a real ordinary diet.
Peanut butter and ate like he. I've read this thing about like he had gold nuggets, which was like a loaf of bread with all like tons of bacon and maple syrup. Yeah, packing. I don't think he was a healthy man towards the end of his life. Which
Jemmy would have never thought that your interview was going to get to these dizzying heights. talking about the greatest artists and their diet.
Yeah, I don't know how that happened.
Now, what we were actually asking Eskin was.
Yes, about your hobbies.
My hobbies.
Outside of netball and Pokemon Go and singing Amy Winehouse songs.
Amy Winehouse.
Who are we talking about?
Whitney Houston.
That's the one, sorry.
Yeah. Amy Winehouse from...
Jesus. Hobbies. I think like we've got... we've just recently bought a parrot.
okay. How's the dog go with the parrot?
No, they're pretty good.
Okay.
Yeah, so we've been like getting the parrot out and teaching it just to get used to people, and we're trying to get it to copy us. Like, whatever we say to it. So that's been fun. But it doesn't really like me as much as it like Grant. It just loves to bite.
What are you trying to get it to say?
We don't know if it's a boy or a girl, but his.
Is there any way to check that?
Well, it costs money.
Just carry on. It's 2020. You can be whatever you want to be.
Yeah, exactly. So the breed of the parrot is an Indian ringneck. And so it's albino and we've called it Casper. So we've been trying
to... just makes sense. Such well thought out names. I've been so impressed with this.
So we've just been trying to teach it how to say butter chicken with naan bread. Or
that's original. I think I've heard that one before, so that's good.
If you're rocking it and a parrot saying that, you're pretty impressed.
Yeah.
That's very good.
Good taste.
Very nicely done. Now, Jemma, you've obviously been magnificent. We've got to some parts that we never really planned to go to, which is usually where the best interviews occur. Have you worked out who the greatest artist of all time is yet, or are you still going on that?
No, I don't.
Certainly not renowned for your speed.
No, I'm not. Neither is our Wi-Fi, so I think that might be a job for a later date, Lethal, if I can get back to you.
Sorry, we'll release that at a later stage when it's kids.
Maybe when we record the outro and intro and stuff, I'll have it by then, maybe.
Okay, perfect. But Jemma, one thing we do normally get our guests to do, I guess, is to give them the opportunity, because we've grilled you for the best part of an hour. We sort of give them the opportunity to ask us any questions that they might like. And most of the time, actually, when we provide that platform, it just turns into people bagging Haz about his financial choices.
Tell me about that.
Oh, yeah, they just say I'm very tight with my money and don't like spending it. So that's what I get a lot.
Haz has got that really condensed. He's got that well practiced now, exactly what they say. Used to be something he'd like try and avoid, and now he's just like, they say I'm tight with my money, which I am, so doesn't even argue with it. But is there anything Jemma that you've sort of that you might, any dirt that you've got on us from your past of playing games against Mitch or anything like that, or any questions that you would like to know about the constant just serious traction that this podcast is getting?
I can't think of anything.
That's probably a no.
That's a good representation, Bill.
Attraction. Yeah, that's right. What podcast am I on? That's fantastic, Jemma. We appreciate you obviously making that 6-minute trip to come and see us.
That's been
fantastic. And we've certainly enjoyed asking you these questions and you actually even inspiring our brains into gear in terms of just thinking well outside the box about hobbies and sheep impersonations and all things. So thanks
full
so much
surprises.
For coming in. Weren't you ever?
Thanks, guys.
When you were designing the document, Haz, did you have a section in there for sheep impersonation?
No, I had no idea. I'm surprised that didn't come
that
up.
That can
with
be
the,
now a question you ask if the people got animal impersonations.
That's brilliant. Yeah. That is brilliant. Excuse me. One question we would like to ask you is, can you do your best sheep impersonation? It's a really standard thing to get people to do on this podcast. Jemma, that's magnificent. Thank you so much for being with us.
Cheers. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. And welcome back, everyone. That was our interview with Queensland Firebirds netballer Jemma Mi Mi. What an interview it was. As we said, very, very entertaining. And probably the first animal edition that we have seen in terms of someone bringing, showcasing a talent other than sporting craft on the podcast. So that was quite exciting to see.
Yeah, that sort of went in a few directions that I don't think any of us had predicted. But it was a good chat. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Another great guest to add to the podcast.
I think we got to know Jemma really well in that hour or so that it was. So it's a credit to her to opening herself up and letting us get to know her and also so our listeners could get some insights into her life as a professional athlete.
Absolutely. That's exactly right. Thank you very much. Guys, we really, really hope that you enjoyed listening to it as much as we enjoyed making it. If you did, then don't be afraid, obviously, to post about it, to share it. But more importantly, probably wherever you choose to listen to your We Got the Chocolates podcast, if you can like and subscribe there and give us a rating, that would be very, very muchly appreciated. Mitch, where can people find us in terms of social media and other places?
All sort of standard forms of social media, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. I think we've got a Twitter account.
We include TikTok as standard now. It's in 2020.
Yeah, okay. I'm still not getting around it, but Lethal seems to be quite fond of TikTok. I haven't added TikTok to the website yet, but most of those forms of social media are available on our website if you're struggling to find anything. So just go to...
You're really missing a trick there, Skin.
Yeah, okay, I'll work on
that. When Haz's pants fell down and we turned that into a video, 35,000 views, pretty much famous.
All right, I'll get it up on the website then. I've been stubborn enough. But
also,
that's it. wegotthechocolates.com.au, so jump on and have a look.
Serious website.
Sure is. Thanks, Mitch, for doing that
for us. What did you have for us there?
I was just going to say a reminder to everyone out there that if you're listening to this within a few weeks of us posting it, that you're probably still at home self-isolating or in lockdown, so it might be a good opportunity to go back and watch any or listen to any past episodes you haven't listen to yet from seasons 1 and 2. And there's not too much sport going on at the moment and everything being shut down due to the coronavirus. So if you're looking for a bit of a sporting fix and have a bit of a laugh, then we've got the Chocolates podcast is here to help you out with that, and make sure you share that with any of your mates out there that might also need a bit of help in that situation.
That's right. The good thing about isolation is it does give us quite a bit of chance to get some content out. So we've got to try and turn everything into a positive here. The bad news, I'm just all for giving positives and negatives here, pros and cons. We are probably going to have to branch out a little bit because there is not much sport to talk about. So do not be surprised if we talk about the start of the fruit picking season next week on episode 37. Anything else to add, guys?
No, I think that's about it.
I'm pretty happy with that.
Magnificent. That'll do us, guys, and we'll be back with you again next week. Thank you so much for listening. And good luck in the future.
Cheers.
Cheers.
And that stumps.